I'm Katie Koch. I'm a partner in Goldman Sachs Investment Management Division, and I'm really honored to be joined here today by Coach McGraw. She has taken the Notre Dame women's basketball team to the NCAA Final Four 8 times, and she has won 2 national championships as well. And I actually wanted to start talking with you a little bit about your time as a player, because people are obviously aware of your coaching career, but may not be aware of kind of how you start off in basketball. How did you develop a love for basketball? And just talk a little bit about your time as a player.
You know, I always loved sports. And I back when I was playing, it was only men, really, that played sports. We had softball and basketball were the only things they offered when I was in high school. We didn't start playing until, I remember I was in 7th grade, and the priest came in the room and said, "We're going to start a girls' basketball team. Who's interested?" And my hand shot up, I think, before anybody even got the question through. And I was so excited about it because I was always playing. I mean, me and 9 guys down at the playground. And just really, I just loved the game. I loved all sports, but started playing basketball. And back then, we had to play 6-on-6. We had 2 offensive players, 2 defensive players, and 2 rovers that could run back and forth. So, I mean, it was a crazy game, I think, invented by men, you know, who thought childbirth was a pain-free experience, but running up and down a basketball court might make us faint. So we had to wear skirts. I mean, we wore skirts. We wore bloomers. I mean, we've just come so far since that time. And I think I kind of honed my competitiveness through high school. And then, of course, going on to college, first year was a sport. We sat on the sidelines, watched the men's varsity and JV practice, and then we were allowed to come on the court as soon as they were finished, completely finished. We didn't have practice clothes. We bought our own shoes, drove ourselves to the games. We're really the pioneers of women's basketball, and it's so gratifying to see that Title IX is finally coming around, and it's working for women.
When you just transitioning a little bit to talk about your time as a coach, is that something you always aspired to do, to get into coaching, or when did you realize that that would be a great career for you?
I think as a sociology major, realizing there were absolutely no jobs.
that helps, right?
That was kind of a turning point for me. I loved playing. I loved it. And when I graduated, I thought, what am I going to do now? There's no option for women to keep playing. And a high school job opened up right around the corner. And I thought, you know what, I'm going to give it a try. And so I got the job. I was thrilled to get the job. And that was it. First day of practice, I was, this is it for me.
And did you have, when you started out, did you have a strong philosophy about how to approach coaching? Or is that something you just developed over your career? And how would you describe your philosophy if you do have one?
You know, I think like most things, the person that you work for, so the coaches that I played for, played for 3 different coaches in college, so I had a lot of things to choose from.
Yeah.
So I looked at their philosophy, how they played. I was always big on defense. Probably because I couldn't score. So I was always the defensive stopper. So I thought, you know, we're going to be great defensive teams. Offensively, I think you continue to go around and watch other people and see other things and learn things and continually, I think, reinventing yourself. But philosophically, I do think defense is really important. Teamwork is key. I mean, it's all about being the unselfish player.
And on that point, I just wanted to pick up teamwork because obviously that's incredibly important for sports and basketball, but also for a lot of people in this room that manage teams. How do you think about building successful teams? I guess from a recruiting perspective, like what are the skill sets you're looking for would be the first part of it. And then you have, just to add on to that, you've said before that it's important that people have a role and they accept what their role is to being a successful team. So can you expand on some of that?
Yeah, I think recruiting is key. I mean, that is the key to success for us. We've got to have the right people. I read a book called Good to Great, and I thought that was really kind of influenced me a little bit because he talks about you got to get the right people on the bus. And then you get them on the bus, you got to get them in the right seat. Mm-hmm. So when we are recruiting, I'm looking for things much more than talent. It's not the best player, it's really the best fit. I want people that are unselfish, that are going to be leaders. You look at how they react in negative situations. I love to see them lose. I want to see them when the ref is making some calls that maybe they don't think are great calls. I want to see how they react to their teammates, you know, when somebody misses a shot or, you know, what happens, how are they engaging with their teammates? When we bring them in, they're the best players, you know, from their state that are all playing together. And so now it's about what can you sacrifice and make the team better. So I generally go around the room and I tell everybody in front of everyone else, this is your job. I need these 3 things from you. sometimes they're the same. I might tell three people they need to be the leading rebounder, or three people they need to lead the team in steals. We don't really talk about how many points you're going to score. Just say, you know, you five or you three need to be the leading scorers on the team. So everybody knows what your role is, but they know what my role is too. So everybody knows what everybody else is good at. So, you know, when they're wide open at the three-point line and their dad might be shouting to shoot it, everybody on the team knows she probably shouldn't shoot that. So it's good that everybody has a good idea. But it's important to have that chemistry. I think that is really the biggest piece.
Obviously, it takes a team on the coaching staff to be able to do this effectively, too. And I know you have a number of assistant coaches. And I think that you're relatively unique in that you have, is it still an all-female coaching staff? Is that deliberate? Did you do that deliberately?
I did. I've always had a guy on the staff. I thought there's sort of a guy network out there in the game. Mm-hmm. A lot of the AAU coaches are men. I always thought I would need a guy to kind of get into that network. But I've realized along the way that my team is looking at me as a leader, and what are they seeing? Mm-hmm. And so I thought it was great that I could be the leader and have a guy work for me, and I thought that was a good thing for them to learn. But then when I hired a woman, and so I have an all-female staff, the only one in the Final Four, one of the very few in the country, and a lot of women, we found we were picking up a lot of fans because they just thought it was so important. In women's basketball, we have an all-women staff. So I think it's phenomenal that we can be role models, that the girls can look up and see success from all women, because there's so many men in women's basketball right now. And I would love to see more women in the game.
So on the point about there being a lot of men, I believe that before Title IX was passed, 90% of college basketball coaches of women's teams were women. And now the numbers, you'll know, 40%, it's less than 50%.
Yep.
So why is that?
Well, we finally started getting paid.
That happened.
It's not equal, but we were getting paid more. And so now it's a field where men will go into because they see that they can make money.
Yeah.
And it's like in any profession, you know, women need to be a lot more aggressive looking. They need to send in the resume. They need to apply for the job. You know, I think we wait to be asked. And that's not really a good thing. Men are great at networking. Mm-hmm. They really know how to kind of use their contacts and use each other. And I think we need to do more as women.
And there's also a lot of male coaches in high school basketball. So when you get the players on board at Notre Dame, for some of them it's going to be their first time being coached at a high-performing level by a woman. And I'm curious if... Do you think that women coaches are held to a different standard? And if I could give you a little context behind the question, in finance, for example, sometimes there's a view that female managers are expected to be warm and compassionate and understanding, and get penalized sometimes for being demanding. And that is the experience of not everybody, but some people have that experience. And I'm just curious if that exists in coaching too.
It absolutely does. I think it exists everywhere. I think the thing about when you look at a man and what you expect from him, how you expect him to treat you is different than how you expect a woman to treat you. Mm-hmm. And you do expect the woman to be compassionate and empathetic. Mm-hmm. And I've never been compassionate or empathetic.
Now and your husband's here somewhere.
And he is both of those things.
Is that true? She's never... Okay, good. So at least you're telling the truth.
I am. I really think it's a shame that we are into those roles. Mm-hmm. And then when you have a female boss, you expect that she's going to treat you differently than the male boss that was there. I think men can talk to women differently as athletes. There are some men that say some things to their girls that I could never imagine saying. And if I did say them, they would be in the AD's office complaining about the verbal abuse.
Mm-hmm.
But I think there's just different standards. And I think the referees, the men get up and scream and yell and on the sideline, and the woman gets up and you're told, get back in the box. So I definitely think there's a double standard.
And what about in the media for coaches? So do you feel you're held to a different standard in how you interact with the media and reporters versus your male counterparts as a coach?
Yeah, I think it's a little different. I think, you know, they want to talk about how do you crouch in heels? And I don't think they asked Gino that question.
Yeah.
They want to talk about the relationship that you have with somebody. And, like, I just want to talk about the 2-3 zone.
One other thing in terms of coaching I wanted to ask you about, and I do promise you that if Jay Wright were sitting here, I'd ask him the same question. This is obviously an unbelievably demanding career in terms of travel and time commitment, and it's not just the season. It's clearly year-round because when you're not playing, you're recruiting, you're practicing, et cetera.
You have a son. I think he's a grown. Mm-hmm. He just got married.
Yep.
I think, so congratulations. And your husband, as we said, is here. How did you make that work, especially when you had a young family? Was that difficult for you? And maybe your coaching staff is facing some of that too.
You know, I think it's always difficult for women. Just first that we have to make the choice. Mm-hmm. You know, we have so many more choices that we have to make. And you can certainly make it work, but you have to have a great spouse. I mean, you absolutely have to have somebody at home that is going to take half the load and sometimes more. Mm-hmm. So if you don't have that great teamwork at home, you're not going to be able to do it because you feel guilty when you're at work, mm-hmm. and then you're home, you feel guilty, you're not in the office. Mm-hmm. So we're still going through that. And it's really challenging. I think there's a lot of moments when you just wonder, how can you have one foot in each place and still be successful?
And did you ever coach your son?
No.
Okay.
No.
Was that by choice, or we don't think
his choice? Okay. I think it was his choice.
But it must have been interesting to see your child get coached by someone else, right? Did you learn anything from that?
Absolutely.
Experience?
You know, it's funny you said that. It changed my coaching philosophy because I would say, I was watching him, even in seventh and eighth grade, playing basketball. And so sometimes, because I wasn't always there for games, I'd want to go to practice. And, you know, he finally said, like, Mom, you're making everybody nervous. You're making the coach nervous. Stop coming to practice. So when they're in the games, I would watch, how's the coach talking to him? You know, I want to know, you know, when he's coming in and out of the game, you know, like, what is he saying? And I started to think, wow, this is what my parents are thinking. What mm-hmm. is she saying to my daughter? You know, what's going on in the locker room? What did she say after the game? Was she positive? And so I think it changed me completely. I think I've become a much more leaning towards trying to be sympathetic.
Yeah. Not fully there,
not
but
fully
making
there yet,
an effort.
But definitely more cognizant of what am I saying and how am I saying, yeah. how's it being received? Mm-hmm. And that was great.
What advice would you give parents with regards to their kids in sports?
Let them fail. That is the thing that parents just don't want to do. They yeah. don't want to see their kids. Nobody wants to see their kids fail, but they try to turn into Olivia Pope and fix it. I mean, they yeah. are the fixer. As soon as something goes wrong, they're talking to the teacher, the coach, the principal, the neighbor, the parent. They want to get out there and make it easier for them. Mm-hmm. And so the kids don't learn how to cope with anything that goes wrong. So now, as they move up and, you know, maybe they get to the college level, I'm the first person that's ever said, like, no, you can't do that, or no, mm-hmm. you know, you shouldn't do that. And so for them to be able to battle through some tough situations,
yeah.
I think would really help them.
And I want to move now and talk about winning and losing, so to build on this concept of failure. So we know you're a winner. You've done a lot of winning. I think you've had 888 career wins as a coach. And am I wrong on that?
No, it's correct. About there.
Okay. And you had your 800th win when you won, I think, the national championship mm-hmm. itself was your 800th win. So you've done a lot of winning, and we're going to talk about the winning. But I wanted to ask you a question about losing, too, and build on your comment about mental toughness and resilience. A few years into your career at Notre Dame, maybe 5 years in, you had your first losing season. Tell us about that and what you learned from it.
It was the worst year of my life, but probably the worst year of my husband's life, actually. you know, it was incredibly difficult mm-hmm. to try to figure that out. And my thing about losing, like, I have to be able to have a plan. I mean, I need to be able to say, this is what went wrong, here's how I'm going to fix it, and then we're going to move on. To me, losing can be really good if you learn something from it. I think it can be great because you got to fail. I mean, you got to go through some things. You figure out who you are. I think you learn about your character through adversity. This year, we went to Louisville. We were undefeated. We went to Louisville. We lost by 40 on national TV. I mean, we were humiliated. It was 100-60. It was the worst loss in program history.
Yeah.
And it's why we won the national championship, because of how we rebounded from that to come to the next game, to come from behind, and just, you know, went on to win. So I think as long as you're learning, and certainly you can learn from other people's mistakes, mm-hmm. which is better, but learning from your own, I mean, you see where you went wrong and fix it.
So if we go back to that moment in Louisville, what do you say when you go back to the locker room after a moment like that?
You know, I try not to say too much immediately after the game because the emotion is mm-hmm. too much. And
is that something you learned over your career?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So you had some bad moments doing that?
I've had a few.
Yeah.
They get really good at ducking erasers and highlighters. But, you know, I think I like to watch it because you know you see a little bit of it, and mm-hmm. so I want to go home. I want to watch it, take the emotion out of it, come mm-hmm. back the next day, show them the clips. You know, here's where we went wrong. But that game was hard because we didn't work. We didn't compete. We didn't even try. Mm-hmm. And that was what we talked about in the locker room after the game was that is not Notre Dame basketball. We're not even competing on the floor. That was embarrassing.
Everybody in this room is probably aware that not only did Coach McGraw and the women's Notre Dame basketball team have win the national championship, but the way that they did it was extremely exciting. Just if you could give a little context in terms of that, how you got to that victory, because in many ways it was really improbable in terms of the adversity the team was facing.
It was tremendously improbable. Right off the front part of the season, our All-American ACC Player of the Year had torn her ACL in the NCAA tournament the year before, and she decided she wasn't going to be ready to play this year. So we're down an All-American to start the season. So we have a transfer in from Nebraska, Jessica Shepherd, who became eligible. So that, you know, it was a little bit of a trade-off. And then a couple weeks into practice, our point guard tore her ACL. And yeah. then a couple more weeks, another player tore her ACL. And then we go into the ACC tournament, and our now point guard tore her ACL. So we have four ACL tears.
Which is more losses than you had, right?
We have more ACLs than losses. And, everything's so precarious because nobody else can get hurt. You know, we have seven scholarship players, and you can't turn an ankle. We can't get into foul trouble. There's just so many things that we had to change. So for us to go through the season and get a number one seed, I thought was amazing. Mm-hmm. I actually thought we were going to be a two seed. So to get a one seed, and then you know we had to travel all the way out west to play Oregon, who's a really good team out west. And then you know to beat them and get back to the Final Four, I felt like this team is overachieved just to get here. We've definitely hit our potential. And then to continue to go on and two huge wins over Connecticut, who's the favorite. You know, they were the team everybody thought would win. And to beat them on a last-second shot by Arike, and then to come back and do it again two nights later, it's just astounding.
That moment when she did do the shot, what did that feel like watching?
Well, it was interesting because the play was to get the ball inside. She'd been playing well. Their big kid had fouled out, so we're trying to go inside. But plan B was the screen for Arike to come off and get the ball. I thought they were going to foul her. We're going to bring it in again. So for her to even get the shot off, I thought was pretty amazing. You could see the defender right in her face. When she let it go, I thought it has a chance. And it was so high, I felt like it took minutes to get in. And when it went in, I know my face, I was shocked.
You had a great reaction there.
And just completely improbable and so rewarding for everything that we went through.
And have you ever you've coached and not only basketball, but are a big fan of sports in general. I mean, have you ever seen someone do something like two games in a row to have a, it's
never,
amazing.
Not right? in any pro or college game. And I don't think it'll ever happen again twice. Yeah. You know, and the cover of Sports Illustrated said ice twice. Yeah. With a picture of Arike taking the shot, and incidentally, my shoe was in the corner of that Sports Illustrated. So I did technically make the cover of Sports Illustrated. But just amazing Final Four, is the best ever.
Yeah, so I wanted to pick up on that, which is that I come from a big Notre Dame family, so we watched that game together. And at the end, I said, wow, that's such a great moment for the Notre Dame women's basketball program. And my husband corrected me. He said, no, that's a great moment for women's hoops in general.
It was a great moment for women's sports. I think people that weren't even basketball fans, because it was Easter Sunday, everybody's home with their family, turn on the TV, and it's pretty exciting. So it definitely was a moment when people that aren't, they're very casual fans, if fans at all, suddenly were interested in what was going on. And so they started to follow it a little bit more. The WNBA was up 35% this summer in terms of viewership. So okay. I think people started to get excited about women's sports and certainly women's basketball.
And it's pressure for you, too, as a coach. You just won the national championship. The bar is raised. I'm not trying to make you nervous here. And we deal with that in business, too. Just expectations get elevated, and then you have a new benchmark to be. I mean, how do you handle that personally?
Yeah, it's tough. You know, it's what have you done for me lately? Mm-hmm. You know, you kind of want to bask in it, and we certainly have done that. We've enjoyed our postseason, taking our trophy around. and really having a lot of fun with that, but you know people are already saying what about next year? You know, what are you going to do next year? We're preseason number one. We got a big target on our back. you have to continue to perform at that high level. And, you know, our expectations haven't changed. Everybody coming in knows, but we've got to probably be a little more deliberate, a little more disciplined mm-hmm. in making sure that we're not trying to take any shortcuts. I think there's a tendency to relax a little bit mm-hmm. When you've had success and think, well, it, you know, it came last year under horrible odds. Yeah. So this year with all these people, it's going to be easier. So I think it's up to us as the leader to really make sure that we're kind of on them a little bit harder, demanding a little bit more. But you have to enjoy the victories. You know, mm-hmm. you got to celebrate the victories as you're going along. And that's something that I've found hard to do until the very end.
And pivoting slightly to a different sport, I wanted to ask you something that got a lot of media attention recently around Serena Williams. Mm-hmm. So obviously one of the world's greatest tennis players. She was in the finals of the U.S. Open a couple of weeks ago, and she got in, you know, through her racket, got into a disagreement with the ump, and it was portrayed in the media as a major meltdown. And there was dialogue about whether this was a double standard, and if she was a male athlete, would it have been viewed in the same way? Just curious what your perspective is.
I thought it was a complete double standard. I think that when you saw the clips of McEnroe and some of the other tennis players in the past that have, you know, done crazy things on mm-hmm. the court and not even been penalized at all, to hear her, because I heard the clips and I heard mm-hmm. the way she was talking, and it was very controlled. She was mad, but women, we're not allowed to be mad. You know, we get emotional, hysterical, and meltdown. Men argue and are outspoken. So it's completely the way we're portrayed in the media. There was a picture in the New York Post, I think, of the Yankee manager yelling in the referee's face, or the umpire's face, and it said, "Argues the call." And then the picture of Serena doing the same thing from a little bigger distance, saying Serena has a meltdown. Yeah. So I think the media really has portrayed that to be very different, men versus women.
And that will get solved, do you think, with just time, or what do you think the solution is?
Yeah, I mean, it's been 40 or 50 years. I think we've come a long way, and mm-hmm. she is doing so many great things for women of all sports. She's working for her daughter, and that's when maybe it'll be fixed.
I want to thank you so much, Coach McGraw, for being here, for everything that you've done for the University of Notre Dame and women's basketball. And I think, as everyone heard here today, just for women in general, very inspiring talk, and you're a very inspiring person. So
thank you
very much.
Appreciate being here. Thank you.